that is 43-year-old male presented with ACS, evolved anterior wall MI, delayed presentation. And ECG shows extensive anterior wall MI, loss of R waves. At the time of admission, SpO2 was 78% and lactates were 2. And patient presented with a decompensated heart failure, hypertension, SCI, that is class B. So investigation showed NT-proBNP markedly elevated and creatinine 0.89, GFR 90. So angiogram shows LAD proximal 100% occlusion, OM1 inferior branch 70 to 80%. So here is the case. Then 2 days we stabilized with the diuretics and ionotric support. Once stabilized, then we took him for procedure. And this is as usual, the standard protocol. We did the plasty and final result was good. And 1 week later, he came with the Dressler syndrome. There was a significant pericardial effusion, moderate effusion. Patient came with hypertension and markedly elevated lactate levels. Lactates almost 12 and hypoxia. And echo showed moderate effusion, RV collapse and severe LV dysfunction, IVC plethora. Then because of the presentation, we immediately tried to, because already dysfunctional LV, we wanted to relieve the pericardial fluid so that myocardium can function much better. So we removed 250 ml of pericardial fluid. Despite that, the pressure is not improving. Then we gave additional IABP support. So this is the hemodynamic assessment of the patient. And RA pressure is high, RV pressure is, and PA pressure is also high. And LV wedge pressure is 24. So immediately, this patient, because of the extensive anterior wall MI, myocardial dysfunction, the plan is to go with IABP. Suppose with IABP, hemodynamic improvement is not improving and lactates are raising. If the allogemia develops, plan is to go for the ECMO. So these are the stroke volume was 3.4 liter, 34 ml, cardiac output 3.27 and cardiac index 1.49 with IABP. This is post IABP. So before IABP, that it was almost 4.4 output. So unfortunately, with IABP, the market fall in the lactate levels and improved hemodynamic status. But 2 days later, he was showing oligemia. And we discussed the exit strategy, like going ahead with ECMO and then subsequently go for LVAD or cardiac transplant. But they were due to paucity of funds, we couldn't do, then we lost him for 24 hours later. So what are the best strategies? Protocol based upon these four registries, identify early cardiogenic shock and try to induct the MCS as early as possible. Aggressive titration of the inotropes is very important. If you prolong inotropes with high doses, definitely carries more mortality. Early identification of the RV dysfunction and support the RV early and identify inadequate LV support. Suppose inadequate LV support, escalation of the MCS is very important and systematic use of RSC is very important to guide the therapy. The SCI has published a very beautiful article and this is etiology of shock to identify and treat accordingly and shock the stage whether patient belongs to A, B, C, D, and accordingly, you can choose the device. Is it a biventricular or univentricular? If it is a right univentricular, left ventricular dominant, or right ventricular dominant, you decide. And as the stage increases, the mortality drastically increases. So supporting device, you have to give a more effective devices, like a suppose extreme risk, extreme, that is stage E is there, then you have to give the ECMO or Impella 5, that 2.5 or CP is not adequate, IAB not at all effective in D and E stage. So as the stage increases, like a DE stage requires very maximum mortality, in such cases, definitely they need early escalation of the MCH and try to reverse the SCI stage, that is very important. So this slide shows if you are using more and more inotropes, the mortality drastically increases. At the same time, patients who are undergoing monitoring, hemodynamic monitoring, they do well compared to the patients who are not. The most important factor estimation of the CPO and lactate levels. So admission, if it is lactate level less than 4, they carry very good prognosis, 4 to 8, moderate risk. If more than 8, they carry extremely high risk. So if the CPO is less than 0.6, and if the lactate levels are high, their survival is worse compared to the persons with more than 0.6 CPO. And CPO with the number of inotropes, if the more inotropes and CPO is less, they carry very high risk. That is the reason always estimate the CPO to determine the prognosis. So before you go with any MCS support, rule out the irreversible cardiac failure with a lack of an exit strategy. So patient should have an option of, he should be opt for like a cardiac transplant or a durable MCS. Otherwise, without exit strategy, don't go ahead with the MCS support, temporary MCS support. And rule out the concomitant irreversible non-cardiac multi-organ failure, other terminal illnesses before going with temporary MCS support. So if you see the cardiogenic shock, many patients are with the biventricular shock. So in such cases, you have to give a more effective devices. So when you are giving the MCS support, you ensure that systemic perfusion is adequate. So that whatever you, unless the tissue perfusion is not going to improve, the lactate levels will not come down and outcome will not improve, and minimize the complications. So go with the devices which are with like a anti-grade perfusion, all those things you have to follow. And the thinner device is much better when you choose it. So minimize the vascular complication. You should have exit pathway and recovery. You follow whether patient is recovering or not, and also think for heart replacement therapies. So monitor him clinically and based on investigations like echo, lactates and biochemical parameters, hemodynamically see the wedge pressure, PA pressures, and multi-organ dysfunction. If the more number of organs are dysfunctional, they carry more risk. So ABG lactates are very, very important, and also monitor the device-related complications. So this is a case, it's very difficult to operate such patients without MCS support. It's a 54-year-old male, hypertensive, present with acute antral MI, acute decompensated heart failure, and 2D echo severe LV dysfunction, EF 28%, and as usual, NT-proBNP 30,000, that itself indicates very severe LV dysfunction, and you can see the CPO 1.3 with Impella, PAPI 4.9, cardiac output 5.4, LVDP, this patient we added Impella, this is the, so always when you do the MCS support, estimate the CPO, and if it's less than 0.6, definitely calculate the PAPI. If the PAPI is it less than 0.9, then if it's less than 0.9, there is associated RV dysfunction. So you support the RV as well, or the device which can support the RV and LV, that's a mandatory. So always assess the clinical status and the hemodynamic status. Initially, manage well, stabilize him, and after that, decide is it RV dominant, LV dominant, or biventricular based on that, you can choose. So at risk of cardiac failure, suppose if you see a patient with a patient at risk of cardiogenic shock, assess the LVDP, and you can go ahead with a right radial approach. If the LVDP is not significantly elevated, still you can continue it. But while doing the process, if the LVDP goes up, you can think of the MCS support. If the cardiogenic shock, pre-PCI assess, and always the as I mentioned earlier, whether decide whether it's LV dominant, RV dominant, biventricular, and choose the device accordingly, like whether you want to give ECMO or Impella. So if there is cardiac arrest, cardiac arrest patients, definitely ECMO plays a bigger role because ECMO can provide the oxygenation needed to perfusion. So that scores there where it scores over the Impella as well as the IABP. So regarding this one, this is a strategy. Already earlier speakers mentioned about these, like choosing the parameters, whether patient is having a biventricular dysfunction, left ventricular dysfunction, right ventricular dysfunction. But in India, we have only IABP, ECMO, and Impellas, even right now, right side Impella is also available. So based upon that, you can choose, like as a biventricular dysfunction, you can go with the ECMO rather than the right-sided Impella, which is more expensive and more bulkier compared to the. But you can left-sided severe dysfunction. You start with the Impella CP. Still, the parameters are not improving. Output is not good. Then you can escalate it to Impella 5. So these are the options. So this patient, again, we did the, because the, on Impella, we assessed the IVS. I was showed a significant calcification of the LAD as well as the LCX assessment, severely calcified, both vessels, Then you can see we delivered IVL, the C2 plus and LAD. Again, this is like a routine angioplasty. Again, we did the LCX IVL and the stenting of the proximal LCX and again LAD stenting. So I'm focusing more on the concept of the MCS compared to the, instead of going ahead with the technical details, so this is the IVAS assessment, excellent result. You can nicely expand the stent. And always when you wean off the impeller, anyhow, the Dr. Sanjeev is an authority and he's a proctor for MCS. He's going to deliver that lecture. I will skip it. Always monitor, like a, you have to come to P2 level before you wean off. And when you wean off, LV, ADP should not go up. And both tracings like impeller flow and the native flow should cross this, the tracing should cross. That is very important. And always weaning protocol, already he's going to tell. I don't want to stress on this one. But before you wean off, always is he improving clinically? Is he improving biochemical, like lactates are clearing or not? Creatinine is coming down, output maintained or not? No organ dysfunction, confusion stage should not be there. And all parameters, hemodynamic parameters improved or not. This you have to assess clinically, biochemically, hemodynamically before you wean off. So once you, when you are weaning off, if that, well, again, if there is deterioration of hemodynamic, clinical and biochemical, then you have to go with escalation strategy. That's how you have to manage. Suppose it repeated attempts fails, you should think of always go ahead with like a bridge to destination, like going for cardiac transplant or the permanent LVAD. That is also important. This is a final angiography. Then show you nicely flowing. Previously it was not flowing. This is another case where patient, you see all vessels are CVL disease. Only LCX area is viable. LCX is very tight, critical 99%. LAD diffuse disease, RCA totally occluded. It's very difficult to manage such cases without MCS support. And we did the balloon dilatation IVL to the LCX because the ACS presentation and severe LAD dysfunction. Because rota, if you use most of the time, the patient can crash single last remaining vessel. So this is the stenting. We use the DEB to side branch, OM branch. Then as per the protocol, we removed the impeller 6 hours later. So after maintaining the de-escalation strategy. But sometimes people, I've seen sometimes 3 days later, 5 days later, they maintain very well. They may deteriorate if the myocardial dysfunction is significant. So this is the patient. Actually, what happened on 10th day, he deteriorated. Then we are forced to put the right ABP. Then after that, then 12th day, again, patient developed ischemia of the right leg. Then again, that time only we did the left angio. Then again repeated. Then what we thought, the right femoral graft was put. This is a trend in the trends where whenever we are decreasing the MCS support, there is a raise in the C-recurrent rate, fall in the GFR. So CRP was raising. So finally, this patient was discharged on 26th day without any complications. So they need a regular monitoring. They need a regular like a clinical, hemodynamic and biochemical assessment and escalation discussions. You have to follow very strictly. This is a 32-year-old female patient, last case. And the patient came to casualty and suddenly developed cardiac arrest. And we went for 1 hour CPR, patient developed VTBF, and we put the ECMO, ECMO CPR, and this is the, with ECMO, then immediately we took him to the almost 1 hour, almost 8 to 10 shocks were given. This is the angiogram. You can see the stents were done, placed. Then LAD was done. Now the flow, because within 1 hour it took place, the myocardium was functioning very well. The patient required very fast. OCT was done and OCT guided stenting. This is the final angiogram. And these are the learning points. Choosing the right device at right time is the utmost priority to provide the best results. Hemodynamic support with MCS is crucial and essential for high risk protected PC and CS patients. Impeller is the most effective MCS for patients are undergoing high-risk PCA or protected PCA. VA ECMO provides advantage of maintaining oxygenation as well as tissue perfusion, unlike IABP, impeller, particularly if there is a high risk of cardiac arrest, asystole, and VTVF. So Thank you, one and all, for paying the attention. Thank you very much.